Good morning. It's Sunday, May 17th. I'm so thankful that you can join us. I realize that this is still not the same as actually joining in church, but we're looking forward to quickly and soon being able to join together. Hopefully, at the beginning of June, we'll be able to join together in church. And we're looking forward to that. So hoping that that comes soon. Today, as we begin, we're going to go back to Psalm 115 as our call to worship, as we used last week. As this goes so well with what we're studying in Malachi. And so please, if you'd like to turn there, please do. Please join me in hearing the word of God. Psalm 115, "Not to us, O Yahweh, not to us, but to your name give glory for the sake of your steadfast love and your faithfulness. Why should the nations say, 'Where is their God?' Our God is in the heavens, and he does all that he pleases. Their idols are silver and gold, the work of human hands. They have mouths but do not speak, eyes but do not see. They have ears but do not hear, and noses but do not smell. They have hands but do not feel, feet but do not walk, and they do not make a sound in their throat. Those who make them become like them, and so do all who trust in them. O Israel, trust in Yahweh. He is their help and their shield. O house of Aaron, trust in Yahweh. He is their help and their shield. You who fear Yahweh, trust in Yahweh. He is their help and their shield. Yahweh has remembered us. He will bless us. He will bless the house of Israel. He will bless the house of Aaron. He will bless those who fear Yahweh, both the small and the great. May Yahweh give you increase, you and your children. May you be blessed by Yahweh who made heaven and earth. The heavens are Yahweh's heavens, but the earth he has given to the children of man. The dead do not praise Yahweh, nor do any who go down into silence. But we will bless Yahweh from this time forth and forevermore. Praise Yahweh." Please join me in praying for this morning. Oh Lord, thank you so much again that you've given us this word of yours. We praise you, O Lord. And we know that as we say hallelujah, praise Yahweh, it's both a statement of what we are to do and a command to us to open our mouths and speak forth the many blessings and goodnesses of our God, the greatness of our God. May we speak forth how good and great you are. Oh Lord, quiet our hearts now as we begin our time. Remove from us our worries from this week, the strains, the difficulties. Even now, just take a moment of quiet reflection upon this week and quiet lifting up everything that you think of to the Lord, in worship to him, in submission to him, laying them at his feet for right now. And Lord, we thank you for the peace that you give. Peace that passes all understanding as we bring our request before you with thankfulness. Thank you. Thank you that all of our cares and worries may be way more than we can handle and far too heavy for us. Oh, but Jesus, you say that you'll take on our burdens. You call us to come to you. All of us who are weary and heavy laden, that you will give us rest. And to take your yoke upon us rather than our own yoke, that you remove that yoke of burden that we put upon ourselves, this world puts on us, and the people around us put on us. You take that upon yourself. And then you say to put your yoke upon us, which is amazing because if it's your yoke, you are carrying it and you are walking with us. Oh God, grant us that peace even now, that rest in you. Be glorified in your people as we trust you and rest in you. Teach us how to hope in you, how to trust in you. To just remember that you bless us. Teach us to trust you, to fear your name and to trust you, O Lord. And so we thank you, Lord, for your loving kindness and your faithfulness. May we give your name glory. May we lift up your name in everything we do and say. And so as we spend time in singing songs of worship today, and as we spend time learning your word and completing Malachi, O Lord, we call upon you to work in our hearts, to humble us before you, to make us true worshipers, to love you with everything we have, to mold us and shape us to be like your Son, Jesus. And so we thank you again. Be glorified in this time as we sing songs of worship and as we study your word. Be praised in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, enjoy the time of singing songs of worship. Lift your voices loudly and strongly, even in your homes. And I look forward to spending some time in just a few minutes together in Malachi.
Buried by the sons of man, but he was rescued by the Father. Matchless love, how great, how sure. Out of the depths I cry to you. In darkest places I will call. Incline your ear to me anew, and hear my cry for mercy, Lord. Were you to count my sinful ways, how could I come before your throne? Yet full forgiveness meets my gaze. I stand redeemed by grace alone. I will wait for you, I will wait for you on your word. I will rely, I will wait for you, surely wait for you till my soul is satisfied. So put your hope.
Well, we're going to be turning to Malachi chapter 3 as we complete off the book of Malachi. We tried to last week and we're not quite able to, but this week we're going to complete off the rest of the book of Malachi, starting in Malachi chapter 3, verse 7. So take a moment to go ahead and open your Bibles there. As you do so, I just want to remind you of some key pieces. One key piece to remember is that really, the book of Malachi is a declaration of God's covenant love for his people and his faithfulness to that covenant love. And the fact that God is fulfilling his love even as they are faithless, just as their forefathers were faithless, so faithless that their forefathers were kicked out of the land for 70 years. And yet God's begun to restore them back to the land. And that's their restoring is the beginning of that eschatological event of redemption of the people, the one that's been promised. And this is just the first step of many. And the first step that, like, we know it's the first step of many, knowing that 400 years after this, Jesus the Messiah comes. And that continues the work that's already happening here, that restoration work, that saving work, that refining work, that bringing about a treasured possession, a unique remnant who's called by Jesus out of Israel and out of all the nations. The sheep that he talks about in John chapter 10, where Jesus talks about having his own sheep hear his voice. And that's true of calling them out of the nation of Israel, and those that are not of this flock of Israel that are also called out, the Gentiles that are called to Jesus as he calls and makes them his people. And we know that there's an ultimate eschatological end where Jesus returns and redeems his people completely and brings them into a new Eden, the new Jerusalem. It's the new place where we once again have God dwelling with man and man dwelling with God. And the fulfillment of all the promises of the Bible at that time in Christ. So as we look at those pictures, we remember the love of God, and that's a big part. And we want to remember what God is reminding them is that they've been faithless. They've been faithless in the fact that they are not treating him as the God he is. He is a great king and a great God. And the way that they are bringing their sacrifices and the attitude toward that of even like, oh, this is such a burden to have to go to the temple and bring our sacrifices. And even the priests are saying that. Not just the people, but the priests are saying that. And that they're disdaining God. And then they're allowing poor sacrifices to come in, and sick and maimed sacrifices to be brought, the things that they don't want anyway being brought as a secondhand type of offering. And in that offering, in that way, they are disdaining God and saying God's not worth our best. God's not even worth our worst. We do this because we have to. And remember that the people are feeling like God has abandoned them, and yet God's reminding them, I haven't abandoned you, I'm still with you, even as I told you in Haggai. My spirit has been with you, even in exile. It's still with you now, and it's with you here. And I see everything that's happening. I call you back to true worship of me. You are the ones who have strayed. You're the ones who have gone away. And so, with that, then, there was the breaking specifically of the Levitic covenant, right? The Levites broke their covenant by their own hardness of heart, by their own not walking in righteousness and holiness, by their own mixing lies with truth, by being poor messengers of God, by disdaining the covenant of Levi, by holding on to the position as priests, holding on to that authoritative position, but for their own sake rather than for the exaltation of the name of God. They were supposed to guard knowledge. They were supposed to be where the people could seek instruction and be protected in the truth. And instead, they're the ones who have led the people astray. And then we see that extended further in the faithlessness within the society as they have intermarried with foreign women who are leading them into idolatry, but they're not leading into full idolatry. They're trying to be syncretistic, so they're doing their idolatry and they're still trying to offer their offerings to God. And God says, "I don't want this. You are half-hearted. You're dual-minded." And reality is, if you're dual-minded, then you have actually you've made a new religion. This is not true religion, because God is only to be worshipped, right? First commandment is to worship God above everything. The second one is to not worship anything else. And so only worship God above everything else. And so they have broken those first two commandments. And in breaking those first two commandments, it's a heart issue where they have desired after foreign women, which is what caused plagues in the time of the exile. Plagues in the time of the Exodus. In Numbers, you see plague after plague occur as they continue to enter into idolatry. And specifically, a major plague occurs as they enter into idolatry with the Moabite women. And you have that happening again. We know that from Nehemiah, that's exactly what they've entered into, that exact same idolatrous worship, that exact same adulterous affair, that exact same of taking of Moabite women for themselves and entering into their religious worship through sex. They've also broken their fellowship with God, broken covenant with God by breaking covenant with their own wives, by divorcing. And then they accuse God of injustice, and yet God says, no, you need to understand. You're right, you don't, I guess in a real sense, I'm not just right now. I'm gracious and merciful. And if I wasn't gracious and merciful, so we looked at the end last week, you're not consumed, O children of Jacob, chapter 3, verse 6, because I, the Lord, do not change, because you have turned away from my statutes and have not kept them just as your forefathers didn't. And I was merciful and gracious with them, and I'm being merciful and gracious with you. Not just judging, but there's a time when my judgment will come. I'll send a messenger to lead the way before the Messiah, and then the messenger of the covenant, the Messiah, will come and bring judgment. And it'll be like a refiner's fire being brought. And so that's where we left off, is this picture of this judgment that's going to come upon them, even as they're thinking that when the Messiah comes, it's going to be their rescue. And instead it's going to be, no, that's going to be your destruction, because you are involved in sorcery and adultery and in falsehood and in oppressing others and in thrusting aside the sojourner, even as you were a sojourner, yet you disdain the sojourner, and not fearing the Lord. And so judgment is coming, and yet right now I'm withholding that judgment. That reminds us of 2 Peter. We didn't get into it last week, but that reminds us of 2 Peter, where people are saying that the judgment's not coming, and Peter's saying, no, the judgment is coming, but you need to remember that they were saying this in the time of Noah, that everything is going to keep continuing as it was, even as Noah is preaching to them and telling them the judgment of God is coming as he's building his ark and is a witness to them. And they're disdaining it, saying, no, life is just going to keep on going as it is. And yet a day came and judgment by water came. And there's a day coming where judgment by fire will come. And don't be fooled. God's timing is not our timing. A day for God is like 10,000 years for us. And that's not like a literal if we live 10,000 years, or 1,000 years is like a day. Sorry, missed that one. 1,000 years is as a day. So that doesn't mean that 1,000 years literally is a day. It means it's a word picture of what we consider a very, very long time period is just a moment for God. And the reality is that all of time is a moment for God, because he is, his omnipresence is such that he's omnipresent in both space and time. So with that in mind, hear what God says now. And we're going to start in chapter 3, verse 7, B. Actually, before we do that, let's go ahead and pray for this time. Lord, thank you for your word. I pray that you would submit us and humble us before your word. I thank you that you are a covenant-keeping God, that you love with a faithful love. And while we may be faithless, you are faithful always. And so exalt your faithfulness to us now as we study your word. May we be amazed by your graciousness and your kindness and your greatness and your power be glorified in your people as we study your word. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so starting in chapter 3, verse 7, in the second half, God says to them, "Return to me, and I will return to you," says Yahweh of hosts. But you say, "How shall we return? Will man rob God? Yet you are robbing me." But you say, "How have we robbed you? In your tithes and contributions, you are cursed with a curse, for you are robbing me, the whole nation of you. Bring the full tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and thereby put me to the test, says Yahweh of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you a blessing until there is no more need. I'll rebuke the devourer for you so that it will not destroy the fruits of your soil, and your vine in the field shall not fail to bear, says Yahweh of hosts. Then all nations will call you blessed, for you will be a land of delight, says Yahweh of hosts." We'll stop right there. This is the fifth disputation, the fifth conversation between God and the people where they're disputing. And once again, the idea of a dispute is to express both sides and then to come to an understanding, right? And when we're dealing with God and we have disagreement with God, there's only one way to bring understanding and agreement, and that's for us to move to God's understanding. Because God speaks truth and reality, and whatever we believe that doesn't match with that is not reality, no matter how much we think it is. We live in a false reality in so many ways because we live counter to God, what God says. And so, and we live counter to it and believe that God's not going to deal with that. We believe that God doesn't care about it. We're much like the people here. But God says, "Return to me." And there's a wonderful plea that God gives. "Return to me, and I will return to you." The reality is that God's already taken the first steps. That's the message here. So it's not that man becomes the one, suddenly becomes the one who is taking the step forward and seeking God when God's not trying to be found or God's hiding himself. No. The very act of this right here, this Bible, every single word of it is God invading humankind, history, and existence of mankind to call us to him. He is the initiator always. And as the initiator, he says, "Come to me. Return to me. And I'll return to you." Which states the heart that God already wants to return to you. God already wants to return to them and have relationship with them. We know that because he's the one who's making the statement, "Come, return to me." He's opening the door. He's bringing the invitation. See that and hear that and understand that. That God still is loving and caring for his people, even in their great hardness. He's just said right before there, "From the days of your fathers you have turned aside from my statutes and have not kept them." That's your heart. That's who you are. You will constantly turn aside from me. You constantly break covenant with me. You constantly despise me. Oh, return to me. So hear that heart of God that's there. Sense that heart of God that's yearning to draw them back to him, to call them back, to bring them back. And when God does this, we're going to see that it has two different responses. And that's always true. But we'll see that in just a minute. But here there's a specific thing that he says. They say, "Well, how are we supposed to return to you? We didn't go anywhere. We're still here. How is this going to go to you?" And you could sense the almost sarcasm in their voices. "Well, how are we supposed to return to you?" Because remember, their thought is that he's left them. And so there's still that heart issue that's there. And now he exposes their heart. "Will a man rob God? Yet you are robbing me." So in their robbing of God, they have left him. They have disdained him. They have broken covenant with him. So the question then is, how have they robbed him? And now he really gets to the whole nation. Now this isn't the priests, though the priests could be part of it, but there's the whole nation in your tithes and contributions. Who's supposed to bring the tithes and contributions? Well, really everybody does. But very specifically, it's all the other people that are bringing it to support the Levitical work, the priestly work, to support the work of the temple, to support the acts of worship. And so this goes back to what we saw in chapter 2, which is that right now the priests are disdained. They're looked down upon. If you remember, come back there. Chapter 2, verse 9, and so I make you despised and abased before all the people. God has made them despised and abased, and so the people themselves are like, look, these people, these priests, what are they doing? These priests are not priests. They're doing their own thing. So why would I bring the tithe in? Why would I support them in that? And God says, no, you bring the tithe to me, not to the priest. Now, we need to be clear that this is different than what we do as a church. As part of the law, they were required to bring a tithe, a tenth of their possession, a tenth of their earnings. They were required to bring it as support for the temple work. It was basically like you could think of it as God as king taxing his people for the work of his administration. It was a legal requirement. And so when he says they're robbing him, literally, if they don't bring the 10%, they are robbing God. It's like not paying your taxes. You are robbing the government, right? And that has consequences that go with it. The consequences for them has been, we see, because when we get to verse 11, well, verse 10, obviously there's something about the windows of heaven that are closed up. There's a devourer in verse 11. The devourer is destroying their fruit, the fruits of their soil, and the vine of their field is failing. And the nations around them are despising them rather than calling them blessed. So by the things that he says that he's going to do, you see the opposite is what's true right now. So these things are ways that God has been disciplining the people. And just as there was a call upon the Levites to recognize God's discipline and repent and come back to him, he's calling the people, look, I have brought this devastation upon you as discipline, and I'm calling you back. And it's not like they shouldn't have known that, because remember that happened in Haggai. That he was withholding blessings from them because of their hardness of heart against him. Because of their not upholding the building of the temple and reestablishing the worship. And thinking that God had abandoned them. Well, same type of heart issue here. And the same response occurred. God withheld blessings. And it was like if they put something in a bag, there was a hole in the bottom that it fell right back out of. If they put money in a sack, the money just fell right out and went to somewhere else. And the same thing's true here. So the same heart issue and the same discipline. And they should have known, okay, if I'm getting this discipline, it is in light of, I need to check the heart issue part of it. And so, because they are stealing from God, they are experiencing this cursing on themselves, this discipline. He says it in verse 9, you are cursed with a curse, for you are robbing me, the whole nation of you. Very clear. Declaration. It's the whole nation robbing him. It's the people themselves. And he's calling them, look, you be faithful to your part. You don't control the Levites. I'm taking care of that also, right? He's already dealt with the Levites. Now he's dealing with the people and saying, it's a hard issue for you. Are you going to obey me? And trust me with the rest of it. Because as they bring in the tithes, then it allows for more of the Levites to be able to actually fulfill the temple work, at which time then you also then have more opportunity for the truth to be brought forward and conviction to occur. And so God's saying, I'm going to take care of that part. You be faithful with what you have to do, which is to bring the tithe. And I said, that's different than what we have as a church. We're not under that same law. That's a Levitic, that's a Mosaic covenant law to bring in the tithe. We have tithes and offerings, but it's a different aspect for us. It's a different aspect in that we're not under the law to bring 10% like a tax to the church. We are called to be good stewards of the church. We're to care for the church as a ministry. There's calls to, if somebody's being faithful in providing the word to you and building you up, then to bring support in that way. And so that's part of the ministry of the church, but there's also so much other that we do, like missionaries, bringing that word then to others, like we're sending them out. There's that support for them. There's support for whatever ministry in the community that we are as a church. That's us being good stewards and bringing those offerings freely to support the work that God is doing here as a worship to God. It's much more underneath that chapter one section of those offerings. What type of offering are you bringing? Are you bringing a full offering, a free will offering from your heart? And not disdaining it, going, oh man, I gotta put some money in the plate again. Or promising God $100 and giving him 50. You can give him 50, but don't promise one and give the other, right? It's a matter of the heart issue. It's a joyful giving that we're to give. So it's a different type of aspect. And so we need to be careful not to take this and now apply it to us. Well, God's going to bless you if you bring in the tithe. Well, I would say that God will bless you in being a joyful giver. And whether that's 10% or 20% or 8%, that's a discussion issue, right? And part of it depends on where we're at in life and what we are given. God knows what we're given. And so, there's that talent principle of, so those have been given, been entrusted with a little, being faithful. If you're being faithful with that little, then we'll be given more, and that's what we're called to. And so maybe we're at a point in life where we literally can only do 2%, 3%. That doesn't become a judgment against us. We need to be faithful with what we are given, so we can do, and then to look toward how we can stretch that forward, and give, and be able, in a position to give more, right? To give more out of what we have, to see what ways we can be better stewards of what we have for the blessing of others. And so those are all things just to think about, but my big point is that this doesn't directly apply to us. This directly applies to the nation of Israel at this time, the Jews. They were called to do this and required to do it. And so he says, if you do what you're supposed to do, like he's not asking them to do above and beyond or anything like that. He's just saying, look, go back to do what you're supposed to do. What are you supposed to do? You're supposed to give your tithe. You be faithful in giving your tithe, that 10%. Bring that full tithe into my storehouse, that there would be food in my house. And the idea is that now I can feed now the feeding of the priests would occur. And builds a relationship between the people and the priests. The priests understand that they're being provided for, so they're not trying to adjust the truth and adjust things so that way they know they can get food, right? Remember, that's what we talked about, that they were adjusting what they were accepting so that they at least got something out of it. As the people stop bringing, well, at least, if you bring something, I get some food out of it. And so the people then see it as not as valuable, so then they bring less. And so the priest then adjusts some more to try and at least get that. And that pragmatism of thought from both sides becomes a spiraling downward to where both sides are disdaining God and disdaining one another in the process. So God says that this is one of the places where you can put God to the test. That's what he calls them to. Put me to the test, says Yahweh of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you a blessing until there's no more need. I rebuke the devourer for you so that it will not destroy the fruits of your soil, and your vine in the field shall not fail. And so he promises to bring blessing back to them. And then verse 12 is really important. Then all nations will call you blessed, for you will be a land of delight, says Yahweh of hosts. So it says, look, if you do this, I bring you back to some of those promises that I gave of the land itself being revived, the land itself being blessed because you are obeying me. So that's the fifth disputation, and at this point they're called to see God's covenant faithfulness. Like, if you want to know if God's faithful in his covenant, test him in this. That's what God's telling them. Test me in this and see that I really am a faithful God. I'm faithful to my covenant, even as I've said and explained to you that it's your hearts that are astray. So come back to me in this one area and you'll see my hand work. And then allow that then to be the beginnings of you coming back and repenting completely out in all areas. Now we go into verse 13 of chapter 3 and we get the sixth disputation. This is the last disputation. And it really goes from verse 13 all the way to the end of the chapter. And here we see the two possible responses to God's call, return to me. There's two possible responses. So let's see what this looks like. Verse 13, your words have been hard against me, says Yahweh. But you say, how have we spoken against you? And you have said, it is vain to serve God. What is the profit of our keeping his charge or of walking as in mourning before the Yahweh of hosts? And now we call the arrogant blessed. Evildoers not only prosper, but they put God to the test and they escape. Then those who feared Yahweh spoke with one another. Yahweh paid attention and heard them, and a book of remembrance was written before him of those who feared Yahweh and esteemed his name. They shall be mine, says Yahweh of hosts, in the day when I make up my treasured possession, and I will spare them as a man spares his son who serves him. Then once more you shall see the distinction between the righteous and the wicked, between the one who serves God and the one who does not serve him. And so in this last disputation, we see this return to the idea of God being unrighteous in what he's doing as they're looking around. And so he tells them, look, you're speaking against me when you say that I'm not righteous. And how are they saying it? They're saying, well, it's just vain to serve God. The idea is that it's emptiness. It's useless to serve God. That's the idea of the vain. It's not vain like arrogant, but vain like empty, useless. It is vain to serve God. What's the profit of our keeping his charge or of walking as in mourning before Yahweh of hosts? So they're being very pragmatic. Look, what's the good of it? Look around. What does it look like to serve him? What good is it? There's no benefit. And they say, look, because look, the arrogant are blessed. Evildoers are the ones prospering, and they're the ones who put God to the test, and yet they escape. So they have a very myopic view, a very, very short-term, limited view, saying, well, the evil are getting away with it. And this is something that we all get tempted to look at and say, why is it that those people who hate God and don't serve him, why do they seem like they're blessed? Why do they seem to get away with it? And the good news is that is an issue that many generations of Christians have dealt with. I can point you to two specific instances where you can see it on display. One is from David. In Psalm 37, David is fretting because the wicked are prospering. And he decides, okay, I need to not fret because of them, because they will soon fade like the grass and wither like the green herb. Instead, trust in Yahweh and do good. Dwell in the land and befriend faithfulness. Delight yourself in Yahweh, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to Yahweh. Trust in him, and he will act. He will bring forth your righteousness as the light and your justice as the noonday. Be still before Yahweh and wait patiently for him. Fret not yourself over the one who prospers in his way, over the man who carries out evil devices. And he continues on. The whole psalm is about the what we need to do when we're looking at the evil prospering. And it's dealing with our hearts. And this reminder to wait on the Lord, to trust in him, to turn away from evil, to do what we're supposed to, turn away from evil. Remember that the righteous will ultimately be the inheritors of God. Just maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow. But ultimately, the righteous will be the inheritors of God. Because the salvation of the righteous is from God. And then the other one is from Asaph in Psalm 73, where he looks and says, the wicked are prospering. But then he says, I go to the temple and I realize their end. And as he realizes their end, he remembers, okay, I may not have anything here on this earth. Whom have I in heaven but you, and beside you I desire nothing on this earth. My heart and my flesh may fail me, but you are the strength of my heart and my portion forever. And so he gets that point of hope, remembering that God is himself his inheritance. God is his portion. Everything else can go wrong and be bad. His own body can fail him, but doesn't change that God is still his portion forever. And so it's good news to know that generation after generation deals with this, and there's an answer to it very clearly of struggling through it. Real emotions. It is real and normal to see the wicked doing well and wondering, okay, God, why is this happening? And to be disturbed by that, because that is unnatural and unrighteous. And yet God is patient. God is patient. We're going to see that in just a minute. We're going to look at that. But right now, the evildoers are prospering. And they seem to be escaping. And when we say that, we need to understand that even as we say that and God realizes that we have that hard attitude, we need to see it for what it is, which is a sin. It is indicting God for being unjust. It's indicting God as unrighteous. And so even as we deal with those emotions, we then repent of those emotions. And part of repenting of it is to see and understand truth. God, you are righteous. Ultimately, you are bringing all things to work for your glory, for your good. That your name would be exalted, even though right now it doesn't seem to be exalted, it seems to be despised. Yet you are ultimately working to lift your name up, to exalt yourself, and to rest in that knowing that part. So there are those that are despising God and saying, well, since the evil are prospering, it's useless to follow God. I want to prosper, so I'm just going to do what they're doing, instead of understanding that true prosperity is an eternal aspect. True prosperity may be an inheritance that is not now, and most likely is not an inheritance now. It's an inheritance to come. An inheritance now is going to fade away. Don't, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So don't put your treasure here on earth, where rust and moths can destroy and thieves can steal. Kind of mix those words, but put your treasure in heaven, where rust and moth can't destroy, and thieves can't steal it. Nothing can take it from, because it's in God's hands at that point. And so we're called to that remembrance. A reminder. So rather than that response, watch this other response. And it says, those who feared Yahweh spoke with one another. Important aspect of us as believers. It goes very much with that Hebrews chapter 10, was it 24, 25, right around there, that we are to not neglect the assembling together of one another, but to join together and meet together all the more as the day is drawing near. And part of that work is, within that joining together, is that we're to spur one another on to love and good works. We speak to one another, encourage one another in our faith, and drive each other forward in our faith. Just as these did. Those who fear Yahweh spoke to one another. And as we're speaking to one another, as they're speaking to one another, Yahweh is paying attention. God's paying attention and hears them. And hears them speaking to one another about God is speaking and I want to return to Him. God hears them speaking these words, these desires, this encouragement to one another, and a book of remembrance was written before him of those who feared Yahweh and esteemed his name. So there's a realization that not all of Israel is going to esteem the name of the Lord, but there is a remnant. And notice this remnant, what does he say about this remnant? They shall be mine. They are the ones that are receivers of the promises. They are the ones who are mine. They are my people, and I am their God. And so in the day when I make up my treasured possession, I will spare them as a man spares his son who serves him. And so God promises mercy upon them. They are his. And he has this beautiful picture. They are my treasured possession. Isn't that wonderful? And that's a theme that goes through the prophets of the people being a treasured possession. That the theme from Moses that the people of God are precious and are treasure to God. There's treasured possession. And as such, they are his. And so we join in as that treasured possession as we believe in Christ, because it is through Christ that we become part of that treasured possession, that we enter into being the covenant people of God. And that's not to say that the promises to Israel are ceased, but the greatest promises are not for this earth. Because even those promises to Israel that are of a land, those are temporal, but there's an eternal aspect of it where all of us as believers experience the fullness of those promises in Christ. And so it's not denying the reality of what the Jewish nation will experience, but it is looking forward to the greatest fulfillment. Not a greater fulfillment, but a greatest fulfillment. That greatest fulfillment in the New Jerusalem of Revelation 21, 22. That greatest fulfillment of God dwelling with his people fully and completely. And so, verse 18, then once more you shall see the distinction between the righteous and the wicked, between one who serves God and one who does not serve him. And so, here God says, look, judgment is coming. As I told you about when the Messiah comes, I'm telling you about it now also. That judgment includes a judgment on those who are evil, those who seem to be getting away with it. They will be judged fully. And in that day when I bring judgment, you'll also see how I exalt my people, how I treasure and love my people. Though right now they look despised, even as my name is being despised, they look despised. But in that day, they will be exalted. In that day, they will be cared for. That day, how I treasure them will be put on display for all of creation to see. And so true righteousness will be established in that day. And not until that day. True righteousness is promised and seen in Christ when he was here. True righteousness, right? And it's experienced in us as the Spirit lives in us. That we have that new man life where we have true righteousness, but we also still have that battle with the old man, right? But that true righteousness is established in the day of the Lord, when no longer will there be sin and death. There will be life only in Christ. Life only in that new Jerusalem and in the presence of God. That takes us then to the last section, which is really putting a picture before us of that great day of the Lord. It's an expansion of what he said. He's already given us little pieces of it, of this day of the Lord that's coming. And now we get a fuller picture as well as the preparation. And the thing is that God at this point sense it. You have to sense this as we're going through it. God is pushing their hearts toward looking with anticipation to Messiah coming. And that's part of why in the Passover Hallel, there's the ending of the Passover meal with the next time in Jerusalem, and it's that empty seat for Elijah to come and join and lead the way toward the return to the new Jerusalem. And in that way, the Jews reenact this promise, not understanding that this promise has been partially fulfilled already. They already have Messiah. You know, there's a fuller fulfillment when there's going to be a new Jerusalem. And so there's, once again, there's pieces to the fulfillment that are there and that are coming. But they're missing that Messiah has come. Elijah has come. Both have already come. And we're going to see that as we go. So, chapter 4, verse 1. For behold, the day is coming, burning like an oven, when all the arrogant and all evildoers will be stubble. The day that is coming shall set them ablaze, says Yahweh of hosts, so that it will leave them neither root nor branch. But for you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in its wings. You shall go out leaping like calves from the stall, and you shall tread down the wicked, for they will be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day when I act, says Yahweh of hosts. Remember the law of my servant Moses, the statutes and rules that I commanded him at Horeb for all Israel. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and awesome day of Yahweh comes. And he will turn the hearts of fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the land with a decree of utter destruction. So, as we get into this last section, and we get this picture of the final day of the Lord, we see once again this bringing back up of what's going of the evildoers who have been arrogant and have been thriving, and the people of God who have been suffering. And what's been happening, and that contrast that's there, is opposite of what reality is going to be. And we see that the day of the Lord that's coming is like a burning oven. Fire that's going to burn the arrogant and the evildoers. They'll be like stubble in that fire and just be burned up to nothing. Right? They'll be destroyed, is the idea. They'll be utterly, completely destroyed from this land. It shall set them ablaze, says Yahweh of hosts, that it'll leave them neither root nor branch. There's nothing left of them. They'll burn as deep down as it burns upward for the evildoer. So there's nothing left, not even a bit of root left. That type of fire. But notice there's also a fire for the people of God. But for you who fear my name, notice that theme has been throughout the book, the fearing of God's name, the reverencing of God's name, the true honor of God's name. Fearing, you who fear his name, look at this fire. This fire is a son of righteousness. Son, S-U-N, of righteousness. Shall rise with healing in its wings. And so while that fire burns the arrogant and the evildoer, that same fire brings warmth and life. A life of righteousness. A warmth from that righteousness with healing. And so you get the picture of a warm, sunny day with the sun's rising up and just bringing that warmth and restoration of strength. When you just sit out there and just soak in the warmth of the sun and just you feel revived and strengthened. That's what's rising upon those who fear the Lord's name. And because of that, then they will go, instead of being poor and downtrodden as they have been, look, they will go out leaping like calves from the stall. They'll have this energy and strength and joy. And look, they'll tread down the wicked, for there will be ashes under the soles of your feet. The wicked are going to be all burned up to ashes and just be trampled upon by the righteous. And so the picture is not so much about the righteous getting their revenge. No, God is the one who's going to bring the judgment. But that that the positions are switched. While right now the evil are trampling upon the poor, in that day it'll be the righteous who will be the ones who are upheld and who are the stronger ones, who are the ones who are victorious, who are the ones who are blessed, who are the ones who are seen to be honored by God. And so we see this change in position. And so then there's some calls upon them. There's some commands that are given. Remember the law of my servant Moses, the statutes and rules I commanded him at Horeb for all Israel. So he calls them back to, look, you said that I forgot the covenant, but I haven't forgot the covenant. I've held to the covenant. And I've been gracious, though. I haven't held the covenant in fullness of justice. You're right in some ways. I've been unjust in that I've been gracious and merciful to you. But I haven't been unjust like you think, where I don't care about the disdain of my name. It's not that I don't care about unrighteousness. It's that I'm merciful and gracious to you. I withhold my hand because of my everlasting love for you. But you still need to remember the law. Go back to the law. Go back to what you see in Moses. Remember the fullness of that covenant. That fullness of the covenant includes the law, and it is do and you will live. Don't do and you will die. Today I set before you blessings and curses. I set before you life and death. Choose life that you might live. That's Deuteronomy, right? So he calls them to remember the law. Remember that covenant that I made with you at Horeb, at Mount Sinai. Then verse 5, the next one. Behold, I will... So look, pay attention. That's what that behold is. So first of all, remember. Now pay attention, look forward. Pay attention to this. I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and awesome day of Yahweh comes. And Elijah will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and the hearts of children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the land with a decree of utter destruction, which is the picture of, lest I come to this land and devote it to destruction like Jericho and like Ai were devoted to destruction, where everything was to be destroyed. Nothing was to be left. If you do not heed the voice, so if you don't look forward and look for the Elijah to come, this Elijah figure to come, and when he comes, if you don't heed his voice and restore relationship with one another again, relationship within the Lord, relationship in life with one another in the Lord, if you don't restore that, if you don't heed his voice in that, then I will come and I will devote your land to destruction. And the reality is that we see that brought forward in AD, 69, when Jerusalem was destroyed. The land was destroyed. Israel was completely wiped from the earth until 1948. The land was still there, but it was not the land of God's people anymore. It was a barren waste of a land, and it was a destroyed land, and it was a land for wanderers. And so the people are called to remember back and to look forward. And from remembering back and when they look forward, then to respond to that voice of Elijah. This reminds us a bit of what we see in John chapter 1. It's interesting that John then brings these together a bit. As we remember the Mosaic Covenant, chapter 1, verse 16, for the fullness, for from his fullness, that's the word Jesus, from the fullness of Jesus, we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. And so here John brings us back to understanding, okay, as we look at the law, we are to look back and to look forward, right? We remember the Mosaic Law, and when we remember the Mosaic Law, then we also remember the grace and mercy that God brings. And it's ultimately in Christ that mercy and grace that we need, because we can't fulfill the law, drives us to Christ himself. But then these also both remind us then of, like John the Baptizer, we're told that he is that Elijah figure. Well, on the one side, he's asked point blank by the Pharisees, are you Elijah? And they're expecting Elijah like a powerful, pre-messianic, miracle-working Elijah. And he fits a lot of it, but he doesn't do the miracles, right? And they say, are you Elijah? And he's like, that, not like you're thinking. But then Jesus explains, for those who have ears to hear and have hearts to understand, John is that Elijah that was to come. And John himself uses the picturing of being that Elijah by saying that he's the voice of one calling in the wilderness, make way, make a straight path for the Lord. So he admits to being the Elijah figure. Jesus recognizes him as the Elijah figure, but not as Elijah, like this hellfire and brimstone Elijah bringing down actual miraculous workings, but rather a hellfire and brimstone Elijah figure of declaring forth the truth of God, saying, repent, the kingdom of God is at hand. Much as Elijah did on Mount Carmel, right? He called the people to repentance. Choose this day whom you will serve. Serve Baal or serve God, but stop wavering between the two. And John was that same type of figure. Are you going to serve God? Then repent, for his kingdom is at hand. Otherwise, you can continue on in this religious practice. But we also see this mixture, this combination of Moses and Elijah on the Mount of Transfiguration, right? As Jesus goes to the Mount of Transfiguration, who does he meet with? He meets with Moses and Elijah, the picture of the law given and the covenant given through the law, and the picture of the prophetic proclamation of the kingdom. And both those figures then are like extensions of the same passage of Moses and Elijah coming and really being fulfilled in Christ as the Messiah, both of them, right? So that's that awesome day of the Lord. And we know that awesome day of the Lord in one sense came already, because Jesus came and John came. And John came declaring a message of repentance and of adherence to the law, but of the heart of the law, right? He calls them, you know, if you have two tunics, give one away. If you see somebody in need, help them. Don't take more than you deserve. Keep to the heart of the law. Don't just keep to the strict standards of the law, but keep to the heart of the law and have a true heart of repentance before God. And so he prepares the way, and he calls the people to be restored to God and therefore be restored to one another. And then Jesus is that messenger of the covenant when he goes even into the temple and he declares that temple is not acting as his temple, because his temple is a house of prayer. And they have made it a den of robbers. So what are some things that we can take out of this? What are we going to walk away with right now? Because this is a message to the people of Israel, but obviously it's to us as well, because not everything here is finished being fulfilled. And we have been drawn in to this covenant through Christ, into a new covenant that's a fulfillment of the old, and it's a new, not the same as the old. It's filled with grace and truth, not just do with this and live, because we can't do it and live. We only Jesus could do and live. We try and do and we fail, and so we deserve death. So one thing is that God, to remember that God's love is a faithful love. We saw that in Psalm 115 once again, that his faithfulness and his enduring loving kindness. His love is a faithful love, and so we are to wait for that faithful love. So 2 Peter chapter 3, I mentioned it last week, but get specifically, when we look at 2 Peter chapter 3, God's love is a faithful love that has a timetable to it. And we've seen that throughout, right? With Malachi, I'm being faithful to my covenant, and it's still in process. And you just have to wait. It's not the time yet. So stop acting like it is, like I've forgotten. No, you're at this step, and fulfillment's over here. And we're just moving along toward that fulfillment, and it is sure and certain, and each step will occur as God has planned and willed it. So we are to wait for it, and that's a lot of what 2 Peter is about, is waiting upon that fulfillment. But then to remember that there is a specific timetable to it. And so we're reminded of that as we look in chapter 3 of 2 Peter chapter 3, as Peter talks about the judgment that came upon the people in Noah's time. And then in verse 8 he says, "But do not overlook this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but he is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. For the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a roar. The heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed." And so we know that God's love is a faithful love, and it's on a timetable. It's going to happen. But notice that faithfulness in that love. He hasn't brought his that day of fire and destruction upon us yet, because he's patient toward us as people, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. We need to understand, who's the all? The all is all whom he has called, right? All of you believe, all of you who are to believe. All of the beloved ones. And so, as that number draws near, then each day that draws near, where more are added into that covenant community, until that number is final, that's when that day will come. That day is a certain day, because God knows exactly who he's called, right? In Ephesians chapter 1, he's predestined and he's called according to his purpose. And there, it's certain that those who are called will be justified, Romans chapter 8, right? And those who are justified will be glorified. And so that's the day that will come, right? When that last one comes in, justified by God, by Christ, then glorification will be coming immediately for that person. It'll be a quick transition, because that's the last day. Well, maybe. There's another timetable, right? There's another timetable in that love, and that's God's faithfulness includes his faithfulness toward his martyrs. And in Revelation chapter 6, I'll start in verse 9. It's talking about the seals being opened. And when the Lamb opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the witness they had borne. So we have martyrs that are underneath, that are there. Verse 10, they cried out with a loud voice, "O sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long before you will judge and avenge your blood on those who dwell on the earth?" Verse 11, then they were each given a white robe and told to rest a little longer until the number of their fellow servants and their brothers should be complete, who were to be killed as they themselves had been. So there's a specific number of those who are going to come to faith in Christ. There's a specific number of those who are going to be martyred, killed for their faith in Christ. And when both those numbers come to completion and fruition, at that point, then we will have God's recompense, that Christ will come and return and bring his full recompense, and his wrath will be full and complete, and his rescue will be full and complete. So we are to wait for it, as 2 Peter tells us to, knowing that it's going to happen. And how do we wait for it? That's 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 11. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness? Waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn. But according to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. So we're to wait for it in righteousness, in holiness of life, in godliness, in expectation of it to come soon, knowing that it'll come at just the right time. That's how we're to wait for it. 1 Peter tells us to rest in that hope, rest in that faithful love of God, that as we're persecuted, we can rest in knowing that we have a true hope that's an enduring hope, a living hope. And we can rest in that hope even as we suffer persecution and injustice. And we are to suffer as Christ suffered. And we're to remember that God's love, that faithful love, is an undeserved and unfailing love. And that's what we have in Romans chapter 8 that we talked about 2 weeks ago. That undeserved, unfailing love that he abundantly showers upon us in Christ in a sure and certain way, so that nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. Nothing can keep us from it. And we know it because if God didn't withhold his own son from us, we know he won't withhold his love that is within his son from us. He'll give us all things in Christ. And that's important for us to know when things are difficult and hard. We can just know that we can rest in that love of his in Christ and know that we're held carefully by him. What else do we take with it? That there's a true remnant that includes all nations. Ultimately, Israel was to be a sign unto the nations, that the nations would see how great God is and then come to worship. Israel failed. The new Israel, Jesus, does not fail. And I don't say that as a full replacement theology, but the reality is that Jesus fulfills what Israel doesn't. Jesus fulfills what Adam doesn't. It doesn't mean that Jesus is literally a new Adam. It does mean that he stands in that same place, right, as a representative of a people. And Adam, as a representative of humanity, failed. Jesus, as a representative of the new humanity, succeeded. We have this very clear picture of all nations coming to worship God through Christ the Son. Jesus will bring his own people to bring his own sheep. He'll shepherd his own sheep, and not one of them will he lose. That's such a wonderful promise that we can hold to. We can know that as he has unfailing love, in that unfailing love, he holds us and keeps us, and he'll never lose us if we're his. And so with that is then a call for us to be like the people who responded well, those who feared the name of the Lord, to respond like they did in fearing and honoring God's name, and in entrusting ourselves to his work, his recompense, his reward. And so we do so. And then we become mouthpieces for others around us to then enter into that same relationship. We fulfill what's there in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 of being ambassadors for Christ, because the love of Christ constrains us and pushes us and constrains isn't the right word. But love of Christ pushes us forward and holds us to be those type of ambassadors, to bring that truth of the gospel, that others would know Christ, that others would would know that their sins have been forgiven in Christ. All you do is call upon his name to be saved. So those are the things that we bring, that we can draw out of this section of Malachi. And just hold on to knowing that God is faithful to his promise. And his promises are sure and true. His covenant has never been broken by him, only by mankind. And yet he stays kind and gracious and merciful. Lord, I thank you that you are a gracious God, that you are kind to us, that you are good to us. I thank you that you are such a great God that you can forgive sin. That you can forgive sinners who have hated you, who have despised you, who have, even after salvation, we have defamed your name. That you offer continued grace and mercy and continued patience. Lord, make us to be those who declare forth the truth and the greatness of who you are, that others would see and believe and have life in your name. May we love those around us with your love. May we love the exaltation of your worship of your name in such a way that we would continue to speak that forth to others, that more would worship you. That would be true evangelism. To love you so much that we share your word so that greater glory would go to you. That we love others so much that we share your word so that they may be rescued from their sin and glorify you. And so we thank you, Lord. Thank you that we could spend this time in Malachi. We thank you for your grace and your goodness. We thank you for who you are. Continue to grow us in knowing your love. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling, to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen. May God bless you today.
Darkest places I will call. Incline your ear to me anew and hear my cry for mercy, Lord. Where you to count my sinful ways? How could I come before your throne? Yet full forgiveness meets my gaze. I stand redeemed by grace alone. I will.